Everyone's ready. Okay, is everyone ready? You'll all be aware that this morning, at the request of the South Canterbury Finance Directors, the trustees of South Canterbury Finance called in the receivers. This has triggered the retail deposit guarantee scheme, and I want to reiterate that all South Canterbury depositors will have their money repaid. It's unfortunate that this long-standing institution has ended up in this position. We acknowledge the efforts of South Canterbury's board and management and staff who have worked very hard over the last 12 months to avoid this outcome. We had certainly hoped that South Canterbury would not end up in receivership, as many others did, but unfortunately they weren't able to overcome the very substantial challenges that South Canterbury has faced going back to late 2008. So what I want to do is just explain what the government has done today, but first reiterate the objectives set out by the Prime Minister yesterday. We have been aiming first to make sure that depositors are in fact protected, as promised by government under the guarantee put out in 2008. Secondly, to minimise the cost to taxpayers. And thirdly, to minimise the disruption to particularly the local economy in South Canterbury, but also the wider New Zealand economy. So we've moved today pretty swiftly to repay the investors and achieve those other objectives. As a result of the announcements this morning, the government will repay the money owed to South Canterbury's depositors covered by the retail deposit guarantee as quickly as possible. So it's likely that those people covered by the guarantee will be paid hopefully within the next month. The Crown is today paying to the trustee $1.6 billion. Which represents full repayment of debenture holders and depositors with South Canterbury Finance. As soon as an up-to-date register of those debt security holders is available, the Crown and the trustee will arrange for prompt payment to everyone on the register. The depositors and the stockholders will not need to make a claim. The payment will simply be made by the Crown. The Crown will also today make a loan to the receivers of up to $175 million, which the receivers will use to repay all of South Canterbury's prior ranking debts, that is, those people whose debts rank higher than the Crown. Caught up in this process will also be payment made to some depositors who are not eligible originally under the deposit guarantee. They will now be repaid. Criteria relating to citizenship and tax residency that could have made them ineligible won't actually apply. And of course, the owners of ordinary shares or preference shares in South Canterbury will not be paid out. The full payout that we're pursuing today will reduce to the cost to the taxpayer by about $100 million compared to the method that's been used with other finance companies. Now that is because if the Crown didn't pay out in full today, it would be incurring interest at the rate paid by South Canterbury Finance. And so depositors could sit there for a number of years if they wanted to, receiving those interest payments. So the full payout reduces the taxpayers' cost by about $100 million. Just with when these transactions are completed, the Crown will be the first ranked creditor in receivership. apart from those who are protected by statute. And so it puts the Crown in the position where it is the only party that has an interest in the receivership, which means we would then be able to ensure an orderly and well-managed receivership and an orderly and well-managed ongoing stewardship of the assets. In terms of costs, the upfront cost to the Crown of repaying the depositors is $1.6 billion, and we would expect to recover most of that as the receiver sells down South Canterbury's assets. We've already provided around $900 million in the accounts to meet the likely costs of the whole deposit guarantee scheme, and we're confident that this amount remains enough, even including the receivership of South Canterbury. And we would expect that the South Canterbury guarantee would incur a cost of around $600 million out of that $900 million provision. The government's taken a pretty careful and considered approach working through the options over recent months, and we believe that the option of the receivership and the upfront payment helps us to achieve the objectives that we talked about at the start. We're making sure that people who have deposits with South Canterbury now have certainty that they are going to get paid. We've taken the first steps to reducing the cost to the taxpayer, that is with the full upfront payment. And the way the receivership will work out once the transactions are completed over the next couple of days means that the government will be in the strongest position it could be to minimise any disruption to the local economy or to the wider economy. I think it's important to stress that there will be no fire sale of assets in this respect. The receiver now has, the receiver will have a number of choices. One of those is to try and sell the assets as a going concern. And I noticed this morning that Sandy Mayer expressed the view that South Canterbury has more value as a whole enterprise than it would if it was broken up into bits and the assets sold individually. So there is an option there for the receiver to sell South Canterbury as a going concern. If that is not possible, of course there is the ongoing receivership managed by the Crown. In terms of potential disruption to the economy, which has been discussed quite a bit, the position is actually improved by the receivership for two reasons. One is that the depositors will get their $1.6 billion cash in their pockets over the next month from the government. And the second thing is that the Crown has time. South Canterbury had been under pressure to deal with loans, to look at whether assets could be sold down in order to meet the requirements of the departing depositors. So they had to generate cash somehow to try and keep going. The receiver and the Crown sitting in behind them now have time. There is no rush to realise the value of the assets in some kind of fire sale. So I think people who've been concerned about the impact on land prices, for instance, there shouldn't be an immediate impact, and maybe not a longer term impact either, just depending how the circumstances roll out. I think the other important point to make is that South Canterbury will still be operating as a business with the existing loans in place. With the receiver there running the business, there is no pressure to call up loans and disrupt the financing arrangements of the many businesses that have borrowed from South Canterbury. A significant proportion of South Canterbury's loans are performing well. That is, the loans where people are meeting their capital and interest repayments, and there's no reason for that stream of finance into those communities to be disrupted. Can I make a few final points? The government has had advisers, independent advisers, working alongside South Canterbury since mid-2009. So that has given us the opportunity to understand the complex issues that are facing the company. So we've had plenty of opportunity to work through what options are going to meet our objectives, which were to provide certainty for the investors, to minimise a cost to the taxpayer, and to minimise any disruption in the wider economy. And we are really quite satisfied that while the company has worked very hard to stabilise its own loans, it's worked with any number of investors who've had different proposals for recapitalising South Canterbury, we're satisfied that the option of a receivership followed by stable management of it with government as the only interest in it is the best option for securing those objectives.
The upfront government payout of nearly around $1.7 billion, you're going to have to wait quite a while before you get some of that money back. I mean, how, in what sort of position are we to just hand over that huge sum of money? And will it have any impact on credit rating or the government's balance sheet?
No, it won't. We've had a significant provision of around $900 million in the accounts, which was reviewed again just in the last budget. So it's already built into our forecasts. And if we manage the process well, it could be that we can get through this exercise and not use all of that provision. Certainly that's our aim. So there's no risk to credit rating. There's no change to the outlook for the government's books as a result of the receivership, because we'd already allowed for it in the last budget.
You're going to be very close to that $900 million, aren't you? If it's $600 million for this, you've already spent $250 million on 5 or 7 other companies. So you know you almost exhausted the fund today.
Well, we're happy that it's adequate. We can get into a bit of a tangle with the numbers between the net and the gross. So we're making payouts to depositors and then we're clawing back value of the assets. So we have been making significant payouts to other finance companies. Certainly this is a very significant payout, and we will spend the next 3 or 4 years working hard to claw back the value of the assets. So in the case of South Canterbury, if there was an option for sale as a going concern, well then you would get it back pretty quickly. If that doesn't happen, then it might take us 4 or 5 years to work through all the assets to get our money back.
Do the people with statutory entitlements ahead of the Crown, is that rates, IRD and ACC, that kind of thing?
Yes.
Anything else?
No, I couldn't tell you the whole list, but certainly those ones will be ranked
ahead of us. So it's largely the Crown in a different way anyway?
Well, I mean, there are obligations that relate to, that pertain to individuals, like their rights to being paid and that sort of thing.
Can I just ask you, in what way is this really a receivership? I mean, isn't it now the case that the Crown now owns the whole of South Canterbury Finance and it's just being managed for the Crown? I mean, what's the difference between what's happening between that and a receivership?
Well, it's a receivership where the Crown is moving pretty quickly to make sure that it is the only interest in the receivership. Hmm. I think that's how I'd describe it.
So the Crown has effectively taken over the company.
But once you are, it's not a receivership.
Well, there's a receiver there. They've got a set of obligations to follow, but they will certainly be consulting with the Crown. Now, the transactions haven't all been completed yet that have got us to that position, but we would hope to be in that position in the next couple of days.
So in terms of the Crown exposure...
How much does this arrangement tie the hands of the receiver? I mean, if they were to say, for instance, want to foreclose on a borrower, would they have to come to you to sign off on anything like that?
I think that they'd need to consult us on anything significant. They are responsible for the ongoing operation of the business. We need to remember this is still a large business. It's got well over $1 billion of loans out there, and it's still working through the same process it's been under with going through with under Sandy Mayer's leadership of making sure that the good loans are in operation, are paying the interest and the principal, and working out just what can be recovered from the loans that have gone bad.
Are those the 175 million, is that to cover sort of bad loans, part of that block of loans, and take the pressure off there?
No, it doesn't. There's the 175 million is for what's called the prior charges. So, for instance, it's been quite well publicised in investment from Torchlight, who put capital into the company. Now the Crown is funding the receiver to pay that the Torchlight and others out, so that the receiver is in a pretty straightforward position of just working with the Crown and not working with other interests.
What happens to those good and sort of bad banks, how it's been split up? Will it continue to operate like that, or will it all be sort of cleared?
Well, no, as of today, it continues to operate like that. I mean, we believe that the management team there now has done a pretty good job of sorting through what's been quite a complex set of arrangements. And that's why it's important we keep the 100 or so people on the ground and operating, and the businesses that have borrowed that money should see this as just as business as usual until or unless they hear otherwise. The receivership of itself doesn't require the loans to be called in or the assets to be sold immediately. There's been some fear that would be the case. That is not the case. To keep in mind about the disruption is that South Canterbury actually hasn't lent out any new money for at least 12 months and probably longer. So it's not as if there are people there expecting to get credit from South Canterbury who are now going to miss out. That process stopped 12 months ago.
Why have you widened this to allow non-citizens, foreigners, to actually get their money back when they might not have under the existing rules?
Well, in the first place, it's a pretty minor cost. I mean, out of the $1.6 billion, it's a net cost of about $20 million. And the reason we're doing it is to simplify the receivership. So they would have competing claims alongside the Crown. So at a very low cost, we can remove their competing claims. Look, if the number was 200 million, we probably wouldn't do it, but it's only 20 million.
So is the net exposure to the Crown then over time, once assets are sold and money's returned to the Crown, about 600 million, or will it be more?
Well, we still think it's around 600 million. I mean, the Prime Minister mentioned that yesterday, and that is after the 100 million savings from avoiding the interest from paying up front.
But not including that 175 million, is that on top of the 600?
The 175 million is a loan, mm-hmm. And that is because they would have first charge on the assets anyway.
Sure.
So any disposal of assets by the receiver, they would be paying them, but instead they'll pay the money back to the government. So there's 600 million which mm-hmm. covers all the depositors, and the 175 million is a loan in addition to that, but we would fully expect repayment of that loan.
So it
because it's the first money that gets paid back.
So it would have been 700 million if the government hadn't taken this step, the net cost of the taxpayer, but now it's going to be six.
That's right, right, yes.
So wouldn't you say to taxpayers who worked hard for their money and have just forked out $600 million because dodgy finance companies don't mind?
Well, I think what I'd say to them is that we need to look back at the circumstances where the deposit guarantee was put in place. And if you recall that back in October 2008, we were looking at runs on banks and serious financial instability. So the decision was made then by the previous government, but supported by us, to bring in a deposit guarantee scheme to prevent financial system meltdown. Now, we've been fortunate because we're one of the few developed countries that hasn't had any bank meltdowns. So we haven't incurred the very large costs that are confronting, for instance, a small country like Ireland, where they're spending tens of billions on this. So in a sense, we've got through the financial crisis with relatively small costs compared to other countries. We agree, though, it would be much better if we had this $500 or $600 million available for schools and hospitals and better public services. But the promise was made to depositors in 2008 to prevent them from pulling the financial system down. This is one of the guarantees that's eventuated.
If this is such a viable business, why were investors put off? You know, why were these potential investors over the past 24 hours?
Well, you need to talk to either them or South Canterbury Finance about it. These are distressed assets. They're quite hard to value if you haven't been inside the organisation. It's a bit hard to tell what are good assets and what aren't. We've just got to look at the experience of some of the other finance companies over recent months buying each other's assets and guessing it wrong. So I think any investors are careful with these kind of assets. So we believe that the company has tried very hard to find investors who would be willing to invest in South Canterbury. Now there's a receivership. It's a simpler proposition, because once we've executed these transactions, there will no longer be depositors or prior charge holders to be concerned about. And so the receiver might get a cleaner run at it than South Canterbury was in the last couple of months.
Where did you get the $1.7 billion from?
The $1.6 billion it will be.
Where do you get it from?
Where do we get it from? Oh, it's just financed through DMO and their account with the Reserve Bank.
So you've borrowed, that's extra borrowing?
Well, it's effectively borrowing at the moment, yeah, at the margin. And but you need to talk to Treasury about the precise transaction and how that's put together.
3 to 4 years to return the cash. $1 billion to get to the $600 million.
Yeah, that's right. The way the transaction works is we pay out today, effectively from the government's point of view, and then in a pure receivership, it would take 3 or 4 years to claw back the value of the assets that still have value, and our guess is that's somewhere around $1.1-1.2 billion, and so in 3 or 4 years' time we would come up $600 million short. Now, that means that there's some attractions in, for instance, people who want to buy it as a going concern, so we've got our money now. You know, that market's been pretty thoroughly tested. That might not be that likely.
So it just seems surprising to me that you can not take a hit on the balance sheet or credit rating when you've laid out $1.6 billion and it's going to take you 4 years to call it back.
Well, I think the ratings agencies and the financial markets understand these transactions because they're going on all around the world on much larger scale than ours, and that's just simply how it works. You make the provision. We've made a prudent provision in the accounts to cover the cost, so the indications are that there will be no further imposition on the government's books than was already built into the last budget.
And some people worry that if the investors as opposed to debenture holders, they might not. Can you clear that up and clarify exactly who's going to be eligible and how broad it's going to be under the scheme?
Well, there is the depositors that were always covered by the deposit guarantee scheme. Then there's a very small group of ineligible depositors who would have been excluded because, for instance, they weren't residents or particular types of trusts. We are going to include them, and we're including them simply because they would have competing claims against the Crown, and at a small cost we can simplify the receivership by paying them out at a very small cost. But anyone who's held a share, an ordinary share like Mr Hubbard would have held, or preference shares, of whom there's 150 million or so, they are equity, and their money is gone.
So he gets no money out of this, his equity's gone.
That's right.
Under the receiver.
That's the shareholders' business. We only ever guaranteed depositors who met certain criteria. And so our first objective has been to meet the terms of that guarantee.
So the objection for people like Torchlight, that
being put into statutory management, he's been sidelined through this, that he would have actually made a word if he wasn't put into statutory management, if he wasn't sidelined by the board. You have a comment on what's quite an aggressive statement from Hubbard earlier on to
Yeah, look, I think he'll be as distressed as anybody about the receivership today. It's not something that he would have wanted, but the combination of probably the rapid growth of South Canterbury Finance without the infrastructure to run a large organisation and a sharp downturn in market conditions has meant he's found himself in this position. Now, there's been a lot of, as I understand it, and I can only tell you what I'm advised, there's been a lot of discussion with Mr Hubbard over the last 12 months over his own affairs, the affairs of South Canterbury, and what contribution he could make to sorting those out. And I think sometimes that's been helpful and sometimes it hasn't.
He said he could have saved it. There'd been loan to save it. Do you agree with him?
Well, there's been ample opportunity for the owners of the business to save it. Mr Hubbard himself has made considerable personal commitments, which I think have been widely respected in the community and in the financial community. However, the options have simply run out.
Do you have any idea of any money owed to South Canterbury by those entities, the statutory management, the Hubbards and the various trusts? Is there any debt from those to South Canterbury?
You'd need to talk to the statutory managers. You have the detail of that. Our focus has been purely on South Canterbury Finance. I think it would be fair to say that with the style of management, there'll be quite a lot of interlinked transactions, and part of the statutory manager's job has been to try and sort those out.
Now, that's Torchlight you mentioned before. You said that you'd had to buy them out effectively. So that wasn't capital they injected, it was debt financing of some sort.
Yeah, look, I'm not familiar with the exact structure of it. All I know is that they are one of a number of prior charges of about $150 million, and we're looking to pay them out to simplify the receivership.
Will South Canterbury, now operating as under receivership, be able to make investments, lend money?
Oh, look, I think that's a decision the receiver would need to consult the Crown about. Certainly if the Crown was the ongoing owner, we're not keen to get ourselves into the finance company business.
So linking that together, so you pay out the depositors, you're not making any more money, but you're selling it as a going concern. There isn't a concern, is that it's not borrowing any money, it's not lending any.
Well, I think these would be alternatives. So if someone came along and said, we want to buy the whole lot and run it as a business, because Sandy Mayo says there is a core business in there, there's hundreds of millions of sound loans and hundreds of millions of dollars of probably reasonably well-run other assets, and I think that's been well publicised, the helicopter company, the farms, the orchards, then that's an option that we would want the receiver to look at.
But if that
doesn't happen, then the Crown, of course, would have to make a decision about whether it wanted to own and run those sort of businesses. And our view is that we wouldn't want to.
Yeah.
And so therefore you'd go into an orderly disposal process.
But in terms of a finance company called South Canterbury Finance with some brand value and all that, there's nothing there, is there?
Well, that's something that the receiver and the market will look at in the next few weeks, and has looked at pretty hard over the last few months. So I wouldn't rule out that some people might see value in it, particularly now that there's only the Crown to deal with and not all these other parties.
Would they have a view if the NZ Super Fund, say, decided to, given that, looking for more New Zealand assets at the moment?
Well, as a taxpayer, I might have a view about what sort of assets they were buying into, but we will be saying to the receiver that we want the receiver to look at any credible bids that might turn up for a going concern. Even if they're overseas. And the Crown always has a choice about if the receiver recommends a bid to us, we'll take that seriously, and we have a choice then whether to take it or not. Alternatively, if that doesn't happen, there is we would have good control of the receivership. And again, I think under both scenarios, we're not going to see a fire sale of assets or a meltdown of the loans or businesses suddenly cut off from credit. But that scenario is not going to happen.
So that question from Vernon earlier about, you've effectively got sole control now, haven't you, through that $175 million loan. Does that give you sort of pole position on controlling the receivership from here on in?
Yeah, if we can pay out the ineligible, well, we are going to pay out the ineligible depositors. We have made the loan. We are making the loan today to the receiver to pay out the prior charges. When those transactions are completed, which we might take a day or two, then the Crown will have the sole interest in the receivership. There won't be any other party to it.
Sandy Mayer said this morning that one of the big problems he's faced in recent months was the reputational brand damage following the statutory management of the Hubbards. Do you think that was a mistake in retrospect?
Well, look, that was a decision made on a statutory basis. And not one made in the context of the Crown's other interests. And I think in retrospect, it's more a matter that the underlying capacity of the Hubbards to support South Canterbury has turned out not to be quite as great as perhaps a lot of people presumed. But the decisions were not made in any connected way. The decision about statutory management was not made according to the criteria that apply in statute for making that decision, and the minister made that independently, and the minister's kept out of this decision making process.
How much pressure have you come under from the South Island MPs, apart from yourself, to not let this get ugly and to keep full control of it, for fear of political fallout from voters?
Yeah, look, we haven't come under any particularly strong pressure. There's been some people saying, look, there's political fallout, they won't vote National, but actually that is not the point here. The point here is honouring the deposit guarantee, which was a undertaking made by the government to the nation, and making sure that all investors are treated fairly and equally, and making sure that there is minimal disruption to the economy. Because the underlying issue here is not a political point of view. The underlying issue is a company that has grown fast without growing its own infrastructure to manage a multi-billion dollar enterprise, and has been caught out by changes in the market driven by the world economy. So it's not a political matter.
But there are going to be farms here are not going to be treated as ruthlessly as they would under the conventional receivership. Farmers who couldn't get money from retail banks.
Well, look, I think that's jumping to conclusions. The South Canterbury has loaned money to people. They've spent the last 12 months doing a very good job of going through sorting out all the circumstances of those individual borrowers. And the company now has a much clearer view of which borrowers are in shape to service their debt and which ones aren't, and we would expect that to have been conducted in an even-handed manner. I mean, the government's not running the business. Up until today, South Canterbury Board has been running it. Now there is a receiver running it. And from the point of view of the borrowers, it's business as usual. They've got obligations. They should be meeting them. I think what everyone needs to bear in mind here is that whatever your point of view about how South Canterbury's been run or the personalities, taxpayers are ending up with a bill of $600 million. And there is a lot of other things we could have used that $600 million for. And I would hope that the depositors of South Canterbury and those who are supporting the company are grateful for the support of the New Zealand taxpayer, because without that support, Timaru and South Canterbury could have ended up $600 million out of pocket. And I would expect to hear a bit more from that community about their acknowledgement of the taxpayers' support of that business.
What do you want to hear from them, Mr. Richard?
Well, I just think they should acknowledge that taxpayers across New Zealand are putting their hands in their pocket to the tune of $600 million to honour a promise made with a business that's actually gone broke.
And left us,
it's turned out $600 million short.
Do you know what the difference is between how much the bank paid to join up to the deposit guarantee scheme and what they're now having to pay out?
I'd have to get those numbers for you. Yeah, they were paying a fee. I wish it was in excess of $600 million, but it's not.
How confident are you that there won't be any more calls on a fund which is now going to have only $50 million in it? That's everything that's fallen over, that was going to fall over, fallen over.
Pretty much. there's not many left.
Are you, then you work closely with South Canterbury. Have you worked closely with any other institutions this closely or at all?
Well, we're not saying that we've worked closely with them. The government's had advisors in there now for since mid-2009. The day-to-day operation of it has all been run arm's length. We're not involved with that. We're not involved with that at all. I mean, clearly this has been by far the largest, and it's been a company where there were early signals of distress, and I think everyone regarded it as a real opportunity to save it. But despite everybody's best efforts, Mr. Hubbard, Mr. Meyer, the 100 people who work for it, it hasn't been able to be saved.
So will you have to adjust government spending and have some sacrifices as a quid pro quo for paying this money? That seems to be what you're saying.
No, we won't, but we had hoped for quite a while that we wouldn't have to pay this money out, and so we would have a windfall gain. As it happens, a provision was made, and most of that provision, if not all of it, will now be used up. But at least we provided for it. I think I can give you that reassurance that these circumstances were anticipated, the money's been set aside, it's there now that we need it, and no other public service will be affected because of the events of today.
But there are a host of other finance companies involved, though, with the retail deposit scheme. There's about 70 on the books, about $130 billion worth of deposits covered there. Are you confident that a whole chunk of those finance companies could go under in the next year or so, or 2 years, and you face a much greater bill than you're facing today?
Pretty confident. Well, we're certainly confident about the banks and most of the finance companies that could go under have gone under. I mean, we can check that for you, but we don't anticipate much more call on it. The big effort now is over the next 3 or 4 years, we need to, we've got to claw back what should be $700 or $800 million worth of asset value.
Will there be any changes to the scheme? I think it runs out in 2011, doesn't it? Is it?
Well, I can just check the details with Treasury, but the original deposit guarantee scheme actually runs out at the end of October. Is that correct? And then there's a new scheme, which is much tighter, that runs to the end of 2011.
And is that just the banks?
No, it'll be open to anybody, but the criteria are much tougher. And Even if South Canterbury had got through this phase, there was going to be a test and yet another hurdle as to whether they could get the appropriate credit rating, the appropriate capital base, and be able to afford to enter the next guarantee scheme. So if there wasn't a deadline at the end of August, there was one at the end of October.
Who is the legal owner now of South Canterbury Finance, and is there any reason why we shouldn't just, you have effectively, the government has bought the company, hasn't it?
Well, the legal owner is the receiver, as I understand it, and we happen to be a close advisor of the receiver.
So can we characterise that as the company has effectively, you are the government is now basically the sole beneficiary of whatever's recovered from the company, is effectively owns the company, isn't it?
Yeah, well, I think your first description is the correct one. I mean, we don't actually own it, so we wouldn't proclaim to, but we're arranging a receivership so that we are the sole beneficiary of it, and that just gives us the opportunity for an orderly receivership, one that helps us minimise the cost to the taxpayer and minimise the disruption to the economy.
And how comfortable are you that the value of the assets that's left in there, you say you've had advisors in there for some time, but we've seen the likes of Hanover, etc., where what's left is a quarter of what was suggested the value was at the time of the transaction. Is there much risk there that you're going to take a bit of a haircut on this?
Yeah, there's always that risk. You've got a bit of uncertainty in the farm sale market, for instance. You wouldn't be quite sure what would happen there. You've got some businesses that to whom South Canterbury's lent money that may be struggling because the economy hasn't picked up as fast as they expected. So yes, there are risks. Now, and that's something South Canterbury have worked very hard to minimise, and we're grateful for their efforts. But in the end, when it goes into receivership, those risks fall to the Crown. So if we recover less, well, the Crown takes the lot.
So under the Titus scheme, would you be paying out interest?
Under the Titus scheme?
Under the scheme that comes into effect at the end of October,
Tata Guarantee Scheme, will this happen again? Would investors get interest back as well as their deposits?
No. No, the scheme's been rewritten. It's more expensive, it's harder to get into, and it doesn't pay interest on deposits.
Do you have a list of the assets that South Canterbury Finance has?
I don't personally have one. I mean, the broad categories are the good loans, the bad loans, and the businesses. The businesses being the helicopters, the dairy farms, and the orchards.
So you're the proud owner of a helicopter, government-owned helicopter and orchard company?
No, I'm not. The receiver is the proud owner of them, and I'm a close advisor to them.
Well, it's nothing for me, guys.
Okay, thank you.
Minions, that you're on.